Hello all, welcome to this session on BEE. The major focus of this session is to cover most of the topics in DC which will be applicable for your internal assessment. As we know, internal assessment is very important both from the perspective of your final marks as well as doing IAS properly will also help you in final exams. So we at Vidyalankar always encourage students to take on difficult questions and come up in flying colors both in IA and final exams. So to get started with, we will do DC. So as most of you know, DC forms, DC is the common chapter for most of the IAS. So we will start with DC and we will try to cover a wide spectrum of DC problems, starting from all the way from simple problems to Thevenin and Nodal. So to start with DC, DC current is a current which is constant. So we know the famous Ohm's law, I equals V by R. So when I equals V by R, if I keep voltage constant and resistance constant, now resistance depends upon various factors like temperature, material and so on. If I keep all of them constant, then R will be constant. So we can say when V is constant, R is constant, I is constant, such a constant current is known as DC current. So in simple words, DC current is a current which is constant current provided the environment is constant. We call environment as V and R. So provided the environment is constant. Now within DC circuit, the first type of circuit which we will do is series and parallel. So we are starting all the way from series parallel and go all the way till Thevenin and Nodal. So to start with series, two resistances are said to be in series if current flowing through them is same and they are connected like this. One end is connected to other end. So if it's connected like this, then we can say that this particular resistances are in series. When two resistances are in series, the current is I, the voltage across R1 can be taken as V1, the voltage across R2 can be taken as V2, and overall voltage can be taken as V. Whenever two resistances are in series, we can apply a formula with name voltage divider rule, commonly known as VDR. Now I will teach a simple trick by which you can remember this VDR. So we can say V1 equals overall voltage V. So the overall voltage is V. Now V1 is through which resistance? R1. So we can say V into R1 upon R1 plus R2. So this is the value of V1. I repeat once again, V1 is overall voltage V into R1 upon R1 plus R2. This is known as voltage divider rule and this can be applied only to series circuit. Same way, if I take V2, V2 is flowing through R2, so we can say V into R2 upon R1 plus R2. So this is VDR, voltage divider rule, which can be applied only to series circuit. Okay. So this is the first one. The second most important circuit, which looks very simple, but people make mistakes with it, is parallel circuit. So two resistance, we can say in parallel, if both their endpoints are same, this is very important because many people get confused with parallel and parallel circuits do come from starting all the way till end. So if I take this resistance as R1 and R2, I can say R1 and R2 are parallel because both their endpoints are same. So if I say the overall current is I will come here and get split into two parts, I1 and I2. So the trick to do this is, if I want to find I1, I1 is flowing through R1. So the trick says close R1. If I close R1, what is left in parallel? You will agree with me, the R2 is left in parallel. So we can say I1 equals overall current I into R2 upon R1 plus R2. So we will take the opposite resistance. So when I want current flowing through R1, I will close R1, take take the opposite resistance. So I into R2 upon R1 plus R2. This is known as CDR. Okay, current divider rule. So again, if I take I2, I2 is again simple. We will close R2. So I into R1 upon R1 plus R2. That will be the formula for I2. I into R1 upon R1 plus R2. So this is known as CDR. Now we are recapping everything. We will go all the way till Thevenin, as I told you. But we are just recapping some of the concepts which are required when we go all the way till nodal and Thevenin theorem. So this was two important circuits. Now third important point which we generally forget is, let's say we have resistances like this, correct? R1, R2, R3 and R4. And let's say we have to find RAB. Now, if I look carefully, the current flowing through R1 and R2 are same because current is not getting split. So whatever current will flow through R1 will also flow through R2. But we cannot take R1 and R2 in series. Why we cannot take them in series? Because if I take R1 and R2 in series, this endpoint A will vanish. So this is a very important point. Whenever we want to find resistance RAB, we have to ensure that A and B remain intact. So if I take R1 and R2 in series, we know how series resistance works. If R1 and R2 are in series and we have intermediate point A, we know the resultant will be R1 plus R2. This is correct. But now the point A will go away. We cannot say that point A is present somewhere between this resistance. So the first important note which you have to remember, which is very important from start of DC all the way till end, is whenever we want to find resistance RAB, we have to ensure that A and B remains intact. It doesn't vanish. This is a very important concept with series resistances. So I repeat the point once again. Whenever we want to find resistance RAB, we have to ensure that A and B remains intact. Okay. So the next point which we are covering, so initially we will cover all the points and then go through some of the problems from each of the topics. Okay. So next important point is open circuit and short circuit. So this is open circuit. This is short circuit. Now short circuit is also represented by a black line. Now, open circuit is a circuit where resistance is infinity. Now, what is resistance? We all know resistance is opposition to flow of current. So, if resistance is infinity, there is infinite resistance. So, current flowing through this circuit will be zero. Current flowing through OC circuit will be zero. Now, short circuit is a circuit where resistance is zero. So, there is no resistance at all. So, current flowing through this short circuit will be infinity. Okay. So, these are two types of circuits, very important, open circuit and short circuit. Now, short circuit has an important rule. Now, what is that rule? Let's say I have a resistance in parallel with blank line. So, let's take this resistance R1 in parallel with blank line. So, R1 is parallel with blank line. How did we come to know they are parallel? As I told you earlier, by looking at their endpoints. So, by looking at their endpoints, we came to know that R1 is in parallel with blank line. So, whenever the R1 is in parallel with blank line, all the current will flow through this blank line. I told you, this branch represents resistance and this branch has no resistance. It's a very simple concept. We have a vehicle, we have two ways to reach the destination. One way has traffic, another way has no traffic. So we will always prefer the path having no traffic. Same way when current comes, current has two ways to go. In one way it is resistance, resistance is like traffic. In another way there is no resistance. So all the current will flow through no resistance. So this resistance can be removed. So in simple words, whenever a resistance is in parallel with blank line, the resistance gets removed. So this is the concept with respect to resistance which we have to remember. Again, this is applicable in all theorems. That's why we are writing this. Okay. So R1 parallel. So whenever a resistance is in parallel with blank line, the resistance vanishes. You can note down these points because these are very important while solving the problems. Okay, so this was with short circuit. The next theorem which we have is with respect to KCL and KVL. So we are recapping all the theorems. After recapping all the theorems, we will go through one important theorems and solve the problems. So what does KCL say? So let's take this example, correct? I1, I2, I3 and I4. We can say at KCL, summation of incoming current equals summation of outgoing currents. So we can say I1 plus I2 equals I3 plus I4. Why can we say this? Because if you see this junction, I1 and I2 is incoming, I3 and I4 is outgoing. So I1 plus I2 equals I3 plus I4. This is known as KCL. And next is KVL. Now in KVL, we know overall voltage in a loop is supposed to be zero. So KVL says overall voltage in a loop is zero. Now, while applying KVL, we have to add up all the voltages. So, the notation which we will use is, if you have a battery like this, and the battery has a value of 5 volt, if I move from negative to positive, we will take this voltage as positive. If I move from positive to negative, we will take this as negative. Okay? In a similar way, if I have a resistance and the resistance is having current, if you move in the direction of current, this is negative. If you move opposite to direction of current, this is known as positive. So this is the KVL notation which we will consider while solving the problems. Okay? I repeat once again, when you have a battery, when we move from negative to positive of battery, that is treated as positive. When you move from positive to negative of battery, it is treated as negative. If you move in direction of current, it is treated as negative. When we move opposite to direction of current, it is taken as positive. So, this is how it goes. So, first we are recapping all the concepts. Then we will solve some problems and then your doubt problems will be taken. All this will be solved, don't worry, within the session. So, this is the KVL concept. Okay, so let's solve a simple problem on KVL just to understand how KVL works, correct? So, let me take one problem from our standard notes. So we will take problems which came in paper because generally that is the question which people ask. So, this is the question which is given. The question looks like this. So we have 15 volt, this is 5 ohm, sorry, this is 15 ohm, this is 5 ohm, this is R. So let me put these ohm notations also. This is R. They are given a resistance without any value and they give 5 ampere. We also have 100 volt. At this particular point, we have two unknown resistances. This is 2 ampere. Let's take this as 3 ampere. So question says, find R if voltage across 15 ohm is 30 volt. This 30 volt is not directly given in the diagram, but they are given in the question. Find R if the voltage across 15 ohm is 30 volt and the polarity is given as negative positive. They have just given the polarity and this is 30 volt. So this is what is the circuit. Now this is a perfect example of KVL. Now, one question which was asked how do we know that which theorem to apply? So, generally, when problem is given, they will give the theorem which needs to be applied. If theorem is not specified, you are free to use any theorem which you know within DC. Okay, so that's the rule. If they give, then you can use what they want. You have to use what they want. And if they don't give, then you are free to use any theorems which you want. So now this is a standard problem. Now when this problem came in Mumbai University, most of the students got zero. Why? Because they felt resistance is not given. So the problem is wrong. So we will get grace marks from university, which was obviously not true. Because even if resistances are not given, this problem can be solved. So that is the first thing which we have to learn, that we should not make any random assumptions that university will give us marks. So let's try to understand this. So let's see at this particular junction, correct? Now you can see this is 15 ohm. The voltage across 15 ohm is 30 volt. So we all know I equals V by R. That's the rule, correct? So I will be, what is the voltage? You will agree with me, 30 divided by 15. That turns out to be 2 ampere. 2 ampere, and current has a property, current always flows from positive to negative. So in this case, current will flow from positive to negative in upward direction, correct? It flows from positive to negative. So this is 2 amperes. Now at this particular point, 5 ampere is incoming, 2 ampere is also incoming. So as per KCL, this has to be 7 ampere. I told you summation of incoming current equals summation of outgoing current. Okay. So 5 amperes and 2 amperes comes inside and 7 amperes goes like this. Now at this particular junction, again 7 ampere comes, out of which 2 ampere and 3 ampere goes away. So at this junction, 7 ampere is incoming, 2 and 3 are outgoing. So 2 and 3 becomes 5. So out of 7, 5 is gone. So 2 ampere will be left, correct? So this 2 ampere current will flow in this circuit. So now what we can do is, we can name this as A, B, C, D. Agreed? And we will apply KVL in this loop. So when I apply KVL in this loop, how it will be? So let's start from this point. KVL at A, B, C, D, A. So if I take this, you can see that I am going like this. Current is also flowing in same direction. I told you, whenever we go in direction of current, the voltage is taken as negative voltage. So minus 7 into 5, that's what we took. Next is minus 2 into R, because we are again moving in direction of current. We are moving from negative to positive, so plus 100. Then again we are moving up, current is also moving up, so that will be minus 30. All this is equals to 0. So now we see all other values are there, we will be able to get the value of R. So this is the problem of application of KVL and KCL in a problem. Okay, so it's very simple. If currents are given, take the currents. If currents are not given, assume the currents. Assume the currents in such a way that you keep the number of currents minimum and try to apply KVL within loop. So that's the way this problem gets solved. We got one problem from Aaron. So let's take that. But before we take that, so I just rub this. We have to learn one more concept of how can we calculate VAB. So how to calculate VAB? VAB stands for voltage AB. So whenever we want to calculate VAB, so let's take a standard example. So let's take this example. Okay, let's say this as 2 ampere. Let's take this as 5. This as 2 and 3. And let's take this as 1 and 2. And if they are given in question, this is A, this is B. Now this is very important from Thevenin perspective also. So try to understand. So from B, so whenever we want to find voltage VAB, we have to start from the endpoint B. And from the endpoint B, we have to find a path till A. So we can take any path. So I am taking this path. Along this path, there are various elements. We have to find current or voltage through each of these elements and add them as per KVL notation to get the answer. I repeat once again. Whenever we want to find voltage VAB, we start from B, find a path till A. Along this path, we will find out voltage across each and every element and add them as per KVL to get the answer. So let's see how this will work. Everyone of you will agree that this is an individual circuit, this is an individual circuit. Why both of them are individual circuit? Because this particular link is not a loop. For current to flow, it requires a loop. So this is not a loop. So what we will do is 2 and 3 are resistances in series. So we can take R1 as 5 V1 as 5. So overall voltage is given, overall resistance is given, so we can get overall current 5 by 5, 1. And we all know current flows from positive to negative, so it will flow like this. I1 will flow like this. Okay. Now in this case we don't have to find current because they are given current through this entire loop is 2 ohm. So we can take this current I2 as 2 ampere. Now when we have to find VAB, I start from B and move along the path till A. So let's move. I am moving up, current is coming down. So I am moving in opposite direction. So the voltage will be treated as positive. So we can say 1 into 2. Nothing here. I am moving up, current is coming down, again in opposite direction. So plus 3 into 1. So the overall voltage VAB will be 5. So this is a very simple way of remembering VAB. Start from B, move all the way till A. Across each element in this path, find out the voltage and add them as per KVL to get the answer. So this is how we form VAB. This is very important from Thevenin perspective also, because in Thevenin also we find VAB. So this covers both that topics partially. Now why I took this problem, or why I took this, because naturally this is a concept. Number two, some student had asked this question. Aaron, for example, has asked this question on VAB. Okay, so positive, negative, again this is negative, positive, again negative, positive, and if you see again negative, positive, and here again negative, positive, 5. This problem is from a textbook with name Ravi Singh. Anyways, so let's take this. So this is 3 volt, this is 2 volt, this is 1 volt, this is minus 1 volt, and this is minus 5 volt. So this is how the question looks. And the question says, find VAA dash. Okay, so find VAA dash. Now, how can we find VAA dash? I told you, whenever we want to find VAA, I told you VAB, we will start from B. So in this case, we want VAA dash. So we can start from A dash and find out a path till A. Now there are multiple paths, correct? You can take like this, you can take this path. Take any path which you like, but it's always preferred that you take a simple path, correct? So let's say I'm going to take this path. This looked like very simple to me. Why it looks simple? Because there is only 2 voltages. Now we have to move from A dash to A. So let's move from A dash to A. Now, when I am moving from positive to negative. So this should be negative. And already this is negative. So this will be minus of minus 1. I repeat, why minus of minus 1? See, I am moving from positive to negative. So this voltage has to be negative. And the voltage in the question itself is given as negative. Therefore, minus of minus 1. Now, when I go along this path, I am moving from positive to negative. So again, minus 5. So how much this becomes? Minus 4. So that's the answer of VAA dash. Hopefully that is clear. Even if you take the above path, you say this 3 and 2 will get added. It will form 5 and again minus of minus 1. So it will be again minus 4. So this is the way we can calculate VAA dash. Irrespective of which all path you take, the answer will come same. So that's how this problem goes. Hopefully the concept which I taught earlier was applicable in this problem. And solved, correct? So that finishes the question asked by Aaron. Okay, many people are asking me to solve mesh, nodal and superposition, Norton and Thevenin. This forms the entire DC, so I will try to touch at least one problem on each of them. Okay, so we finished KVL and KCL to some extent. And then slowly we will now move towards mesh. So let's try to understand what's difference between a loop and a mesh. Please note down these points. These points are very important. They are not present in many textbooks also. So it makes more important if you note down these points which I am dictating. So let's say 5, 1, 2, 3. We are given a circuit like this and the question says apply mesh. Now, when we have to apply mesh, first we have to understand what is mesh. So, mesh is undivided loop. So, please remember this point very much. Undivided loop. A loop which is not divided is known as mesh. In very simple words, we can say mesh is smaller loops. So, if I consider this particular circuit, how many loops we can see? You will agree this is loop 1, this is loop 2, this is loop 3. So, loop wise there are 3 loops. But how many undivided loops are there? So, undivided loops only we have 2. So, loop number 1, loop number 2. So, undivided loop is what is known as mesh. Then, question says, in each of the mesh, assume clockwise current. You are free to assume any currents in any direction. But going with most of the textbooks catches this current as clockwise. That's why I am also catching this as clockwise. So, in each of the mesh, we catch clockwise current. And then what we will do is, we will apply KVL in this loop, each of the loops. So, let's see how to apply KVL here. So, phi minus 1 into I1. You will agree with me. I am moving like this. Current is also moving like this. Minus 2. Now, if I see 2, 2 is between these two meshes. 2 is between these two meshes, I1 and I2. So, since it's between these two meshes, we will say minus 1. And since this is loop number 1, we will say I1 minus I2. All this is equals to 0. So, this is the first equation. So, if I solve this, minus 3 into I1 plus 2 into I2 equals minus 5. Equation number 1. Similarly, we will apply KVL in second mesh. So, if I apply in this mesh, I am starting, you can start from anywhere. I am starting from here and going like this. So, again, minus 2 into I2 minus I1. When I take the second mesh, I will give more importance to I2. So, minus 2 into I2 minus I1 and minus 3 I2. See, 3 is not shared. So, only 3 I2 will come. So, overall 2 I1 minus 5 I2. This is all equals to 0. So, you see, we have two equations. We have two unknowns. These equations can be solved in calculator and you will get the answer. So, this is how mesh applies. So, this point is very important. Mesh is undivided loop. Okay, so loop which cannot be divided further. Now, there are some special cases in mesh also. So, we will cover two special cases just to make you understand better. So, there are two special cases which I will cover here. That should cover most of the mesh. So, let's take a circuit like this, positive, negative. Okay, so this is 5, this is 1, this is 2. Let's take this as 3 ampere. Again, question says, solve this by using mesh. Now, question is very important. You have to read the question very carefully. Because someone had asked a question saying that, can we apply the same solution or can we apply a magical solution on all the problems? The answer to that is no. Because if in question they ask that you have to solve this by using mesh analysis, then you can use mesh analysis only. So, based upon the question you have to solve, and if they don't specify anything, you are free to use anything. Okay. So, let's take this 5, 1, 2 and 3. Now, what we will do is, we will assume, you will agree with me, how many meshes are you able to see, how many undivided loops? Everyone will answer 2, correct? I1 and I2. Now, I1 is fine, I1 is a normal mesh, correct? So, let's apply on I1. So, I start from here, go like this. You will agree, minus 5, minus 1 into I1, minus 2 into I1 minus I2, all this is equals to 0. So, minus 3 I1 plus 2 I2, all this is equals to 5, this is equation number 1. Agreed. Now, what about equation number 2? Now, I cannot apply mesh in this particular mesh number 2. Why we cannot apply KVL? Because you see, this is current source. This is current. In 12th also you learned that if you show an arrow like this, it stands for ammeter. In BEE, it is known as current source. Current source always gives you current. For applying KVL, we require voltage. Voltage is not there. Since internal resistance is not given in problem, if had they given internal resistance, we could have applied KVL. But since internal resistance is not given, we cannot apply KVL here. So now what I will do is, you see the direction of I2. So I2 is flowing, we assumed I2 is flowing clockwise. So do you agree with me that the direction of I2 and the direction of this current source are different? So what we can do is, we can directly say I2 equals minus 3. Because the direction of I2 and ammeter are different. So now how this point goes is, in mesh analysis, if you have a current source, pay attention to this point, very minute point. In a mesh analysis, whenever we have current source and the current source is not shared between meshes, you see, this current source belongs to only mesh number 2. It is not shared between meshes. So we can say mesh current equals plus or minus, so mesh current equals plus or minus current from current source. Now why I say current from current source is because, and why plus or minus, because if the direction matches with this ammeter, then we will say plus, and if this direction of this current is opposite to this ammeter, then we will take minus. So this is an important point. In mesh analysis, if we get a current source and the current source should not be shared, it should not be shared between meshes, it should belong to only a single mesh, then we can say this, mesh current equals plus or minus current from current source. And once we get the current, we got I2, we can substitute here and get the remaining values. So this is how it goes. Agreed? So that's how this problem gets solved. Now we have one more special case in mesh, which is known as super mesh. Okay, so let's see super mesh, so that mesh analysis can be concluded, and then we can go for nodal. Okay, so super mesh happens whenever a current source is shared between two meshes. So you remember the difference between earlier node. In the earlier node, I told you that current source was not shared. Here current source is shared. So if I take this 5, if I take this 1, if I take this 3, and if I take this 4, how many meshes are we able to see? We are able to see 2 meshes. This is I1, this is I2. Do you agree with me? Now, since the current source is shared between these 2 meshes, this problem becomes super mesh. In super mesh, to solve super mesh, the steps are slightly different. So whenever we want to solve super mesh, the first equation we will derive from current source itself. So if I see this I1 is flowing downwards with respect to this current source. If I see I2 is flowing upwards with respect to this current source. So among these two currents, the direction of which current matches with current source, you will agree with me, I2 matches with current source. So we can say I2 minus I1 equals 3. This is the first equation. Why I2 minus I1? Because the directions are opposite, correct? I2 and I1 are opposite. So I2 minus I1 equals 3. So the first equation you will always get from current source. If the direction of 3 was downwards, then it would have been I1 minus I2 equals 3. Now to get the second equation, we all got the first equation. Now to get the second equation, the step is, remove this entire link. Imagine as if this entire current source, this complete link is not there at all. So if I remove this complete link, this is the entire mesh which is formed, correct? So if I remove this, this is the entire mesh which is formed. So how can we do? We can do like this, phi minus 1 into I1. So current here is I1, so it will be I1 only. Minus, if I go here, 4 into I2. All this is equals to 0. So minus I1 minus 4 I2. This is all equals to minus 5. This is equation number 2. So we have 2 equations. We have 2 unknowns. We can solve by using calculator and get the answer. So this is how we solve super mesh. First equation we will get from first equation we will get from current source itself. To get the second equation, we have to close this current source and apply KVL on the overall mesh formed. Correct? So this is how it works. Any doubts on this? Okay, so this is what we have done with respect to mesh. So yeah, star delta we will cover, don't worry. Give me a few minutes, I will cover star delta also. Okay, so let me cover first the paths which are asked common, and then we will take individual problems. Okay, don't worry, we will give some time. Don't worry, you can extend if you want. So this is a super mesh. Hopefully mesh and super mesh are clear, correct? Any doubts on this? Anyone? So with this we have done with mesh. Next is nodal. So let me take nodal. We will also take star delta. Some student has asked about star delta. We will take. Okay. So first let's take about nodal. Nodal analysis. So now what is nodal analysis? So let's take a circuit again to understand this. So let's take this simple circuit, phi 1 and 1. Now we have to apply nodal analysis. Now first we have to identify or understand what is a node. Okay. So node is a point, please listen to this point very carefully. Node is a point where current gets split. So whichever place current is splitting, that is node. Now some students take this as node, which is wrong, because here current is not getting split. This is also not a node because current is not getting split. So we have to see at which point current gets split. This is the first important point. Okay. So phi 1 and 1. So how many nodes are you able to see? You will agree with me, this is node number 1. And this is node number 2. Two nodes, correct? This is all not node, as I told you. This was just a marker to indicate. This is not node. So in this example, we have only two nodes. So first step in nodal analysis is to identify the nodes. Second step is to take one of the node as grounded. So one of the node we will take as grounded. Grounded means we will assume that the voltage at that particular node is zero. Okay. So one of the node will be taken as grounded. Normally 99% of times it is the one at the bottom which is taken as grounded. Now assume some voltage V1, V2, V3 in remaining nodes. So here only one node is remaining. So we took that as V1. So steps are clear. I repeat the steps once again. Identify the nodes. Take one of the node as grounded. In the other remaining nodes, you assign some voltages like V1, V2 and so on. At each node, assume outgoing currents. So I1, I2, I3. At each node, we assume outgoing currents. Apply KCL at each node. So let's apply KCL. What will be KCL at node V1? I1 plus I2 plus I3, all this is equals to 0. Correct? I1 plus I2 plus I3, all this is equals to 0. Now what we will do is, we will express each of this current as potential difference upon resistance. So each current can be expressed as potential difference upon resistance, which can fall in one of these categories. So I will note down the categories there. So there are four categories. So these are the four categories which can come between two nodes. So let's say this is node V1, this is node V2. We have a resistance R. Same way V1, V2, resistance R, voltage E. Here V1, here V2, this is R1. And let's say this is 5 ampere, correct? Now, in each of these cases, let's assume current like this, I, and I. Now, we all know current is potential difference upon resistance. Potential difference upon resistance. So, what is potential difference? Potential difference means subtraction. So, V1 minus V2. Agreed? So, V1 minus V2 is potential difference. Now, we have a battery. And when we are moving from negative to positive of a battery, correct? So as a result, this will be represented as V1 minus V2 plus E upon R. So this is how it is. Same here, V1 minus V2, we will say, sorry, here we are moving from positive to negative, so minus E upon R. Since we are moving from positive to negative, it will be minus. Here, this is very simple case, V1 minus V2 upon R. And in this case, we cannot use potential difference. We will directly say I equals 5 amperes. So, between two nodes, we will have one of these four conditions. Okay. So, one of these four conditions. So, now let's see how to apply here. So, if I see I1 is flowing from V1 to ground. So we can say I1 is, you will put one resistance here, 1 ohm. So it is flowing from V1 to ground and we have 1 ohm. So we can say V1, I am moving from positive to negative, so minus 5. Now second node, we have to see from node to node. The second node is grounded. So we can say V1 minus 5 upon 1. Now I can say minus 0, I am not writing it. You know this is grounded, so this is 0. So V1 minus 5 upon 1. Same way the second node, I2, second current I2. I2 is flowing from V1, going all the way till ground and upon resistance 1. So V1 minus 0 upon 1. And the last one which we have is I3. I3 is flowing from V1 and going all the way till ground and we have resistance. So V1 minus 0 upon 1. All this is equals to 0. So, you see all the equation is having just one unknown V1. We can find V1 by solving this equation from calculator and that will give us the answer. So, this is how we solve nodal analysis. There are two special cases in nodal analysis which we will cover. So, I repeat the steps once again. In nodal analysis, identify the nodes. What is node? I told you node is a point where current gets split. One of the node we take as grounded. Remember, only one node we take as grounded. Remaining nodes will be assigned voltages V1, V2 based upon how many nodes we have in this problem. At each node, we assume outgoing currents. We apply KCL in each node and then we express current as potential difference upon resistance, which will fall in one of these four categories. We will express current as potential difference upon resistance and solve this problem. Okay. Now, one special problem which came in Mumbai University paper, and everyone got 0. So let's see that. Why everyone got 0. Okay, so. Okay, so the question goes like this. Okay, so it came in 2009 and everyone got 0. So let's see that problem. So this is 5, this is 4, this is 3, this is 5, this is 2 ampere. Question says find Vx using nodal. So this is the question, find Vx using nodal. So what we will do is, if I identify the nodes, correct, you will agree with me, this is grounded. This is V1, this they are given already Vx, this we can take as V2. Everyone with me, V1, V2. Vx, V2. So, how many nodes? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 nodes. You will agree with me it is at this point the current gets split. Okay. Now, if I take V1. Now, let's see this node. This particular node. This particular node is very important to us. Why? I will tell you. See, V1 is directly connected to a battery. And between V1 and the other node, we do not have resistance. So in nodal analysis, whenever a node is directly connected to battery and the other node is grounded, then what will happen is, then we can say, and there is no resistance, in that path, then we can say nodal voltage equals plus or minus battery voltage. Now I am saying plus or minus, why? Because here V1 is connected to positive, so it will become plus 5 volt. If V1 was connected to negative, it will become negative, minus 5 volt. So this is an important rule. Whenever a node is directly connected to battery and the link does not contain any resistance, then we can say nodal voltage equals plus or minus battery voltage. Here V1 is connected to positive, that's why plus 5 volt. If V1 was connected to negative, we will have told minus 5 volt. Okay, that's the way to remember. Then on this particular junction, we need not apply KCL. So that's the rule. So once you get the voltage, you need not apply KCL. So 5 volt we got. Same way, if I see V2 is directly connected to ground. There is no battery, there is no resistance. So it is directly connected to ground. So V2 will become equals to 0. So now we are left with only Vx, where we will assume outgoing currents I1, I2 and I3. So we can say I1 plus I2 plus I3 equals 0. So I1 will flow from Vx minus V1 upon 4 plus I2. Now I2 is flowing downwards. This current is coming upwards. So this will become negative 2 minus 2, and V3 will be Vx minus 0 or V2 upon 3. All this is equals to 0. We know the value of V1. We know the value of V2. We can substitute. Vx will be the only unknown, and that will be calculated. So this is one of the problem of mesh. And one important note, whenever a node is directly connected to battery and the other end of that is connected to ground and there is no resistance, then we can say nodal voltage equals plus or minus battery voltage. Nodal voltage equals plus or minus battery voltage. Okay. Now one problem which has been asked by a student with name Somaya. I think he has not mentioned the problem correctly, but I roughly remember the problem. So I will write it down for you. So the question looks quite simple. So this is some resistance. This is again some one more resistance. This is third, this is fourth. And this is one more resistance, and this is given as positive negative. 110. This is 120. Okay, and these resistances are missing in that diagram. I do think I have that problem. Okay, I have that problem. So this is 0.2. This is given as 3 amperes. This resistance value is not specified. They are given this as 20 amperes. Again, this resistance value is not specified. This is 0.3. This is 0.1. And this is 110. So this is the question which... This is the actual question. And they want I1, I2, I3. The current flowing through each of them, correct? Now, again, the steps goes like this. You will agree all this is one node that is grounded, this entire thing. So we are left with V1 and V2, these two nodes, correct? Now at each node, we will assume outgoing current. So this will be I1, I2, I3. This is I4, I5, I6. This is the current at each node. Now let's apply at V1. So at V1, what is the current? I1 plus I2 plus I3, all this is equals to 0, correct? Now, how is I1 flowing? You will agree with me, I1 starts from V1. we have a battery. Battery is from positive to negative. So V1 minus 120 upon how much is that? 0.2, correct? Same way plus I2. How much is I2? Now you see this resistance is not given. So this problem again appeared in paper and everyone felt that this is wrong. But this is not wrong. They are given 3 ampere. So if they are not given resistance, but they are given overall current, we can take that, correct? So I2 will turn out to be 3. While there in I3, it will be V1 minus V2 upon 0.3, correct? So I3 is flowing like this, V1 minus V2 upon 0.3. All this is equals to 0. Agreed? So you can simplify this equation. I am not wasting time in simplifying it. You know how to simplify this equation. Same way, let's apply at V2. So if I apply at V2, I4 plus I5 plus I6, all this is equals to 0, correct? Now, how is I4 flowing? I4 is flowing from V2 to V1. So this will be V2 minus V1 upon 0.3. Same way, I5 is 20 ampere. And same way, I6 is flowing from V2 minus 110 upon 0.1. All this is equals to 0. Again, you can simplify this equation. There are two unknowns, two equations. You solve, you will get V1 and V2. Once you get V1 and V2, you can find out current to any branch, correct? Let's say I want current I1. You know, I1 current is V1 minus 120 upon 0.2, that way. So this is how this question gets solved. Hopefully that answers the question asked by Somaya. Okay. So we have couple more questions which are asked by some student. So one student asks, again, questions are incomplete. Please submit complete questions. Otherwise, I will have to assume some values. And okay, so the questions has to be complete. So one student with name Shiny Alexander has submitted this question on Node. So we will take one more question on Node. Okay, so which is positive negative. By any chance, Shiny, can you tell me what is this voltage? Because that is not mentioned. It is 120. This is 15. This is 5. This is given as 10. This is given as ground add in the question. This is 20. This is 5. We have this resistance value missing and this voltage may be 45
voltage. 20.
This is what we have. Okay. So this is the question. Now I think we have to apply by nodal because one of them is grounded. So let's take nodes, correct? So how many nodes? One is grounded already. You will agree with me. This is node 1, V1. This is second node, V2. This one is already grounded. This is V3. Agreed? Now, this is a special case which is known as super node. Now, what is super node? If a battery is present between two nodes and none of these two nodes are grounded, then we say the problem is super node. Then we say the problem is super node. So, this is a super node problem. Okay? Because we have a battery shared between two nodes and none of them are grounded. You see, none of them are grounded. So this problem becomes super node. In super node, the first equation you will get from battery itself. So if you see, the positive of 45 is with V1. The negative of 45 is with V3. So we can say V1 minus V3 equals 45. Okay? So the first equation where you will get from, what you can say, battery itself. To get the second equation, consider this entire thing as a single node. So consider this entire, both V1 and V2 as a single node and assume outgoing currents. So let's say here I1, here I2, agreed? Here I3, and here I4. So we have these four currents. If I consider all of these as a single node, so what can we say? I1 plus I2 plus I3 plus I4, all this is equals to 0. Okay, so I1 is flowing from V1, it's going all the way till ground. In between we have a battery, so V1 minus 120 upon 15 plus what is I2? V1 minus V2 upon 20, same way, plus I3 is V3 minus V2 upon 10, and the last one is I4, which is V3 minus 20 upon 5. All this is equals to 0. So that is equation number 2. So we have two equations now. Equation number 1 and equation number 2. You can solve this. This will give you equation number 2. Now, so we are done with V1 and V3. They form super node. Now we have V2. So at V2, again, we will assume outgoing current. So I5, I6, I7. Remember, at each node, we have to assume outgoing current. So here, what will be the equation? I5 plus I6 plus I7, all this is equals to 0. Okay. So I5 is how much? I5 is flowing from V2 to V1 upon 20 plus I6 is V2 minus V3 upon 10 plus I7 is V2 by 5. All this is equals to 0. That's it. So we have three equations, we have three unknowns. If you solve that, you will get the answer. So this is super node. Thanks for Shiny, because of which I could also explain this concept of super node. So super node, you get the first equation from the nodes itself. Both the nodes has to be non-grounded. That is important. Battery present between two non-grounded nodes. Okay.
Magical.
Yes, you will answer that. So magical approach is actually not there in your syllabus and you cannot apply it to anything. But since you asked this question about how to use magical approach to any circuit problem, that is not recommended as per Mumbai University. So even if you try to solve it and if you score good marks, it's quite possible they will, do not give marks to it, correct? So you should prefer following the steps of each of these theorems to solve it. Okay, so we are done with Shiny's question. So we are done with nodal analysis. We have a couple more questions by Sakshi and Sakshi, which we will try to solve at the end of this session after we cover some more concepts on Thevenin. So let's start with Thevenin. Okay, because that's an important theorem. Now, what did Thevenin say? Thevenin told that you give me a very complex circuit. You give me an extremely complex circuit and you tell us through this circuit which resistance you want current. So Thevenin told, give a very complex circuit and you tell me through which resistance you want current, that is RL. Then he told he will be able to convert this complex circuit to a very simple circuit, VTH in series with RTH, which is further in series with RL. VTH in series with RTH, which is further in series with RL. Now you will agree with me, RTH and RL are in series. So we can say IL equals VTH upon RTH plus RL. So this is what is known as Thevenin theorem. So Thevenin theorem says any complex circuit can be reduced to this simple circuit with VTH and RTH and RL in series. So overall current will be VTH upon RTH plus RL. So this is Thevenin theorem. Now question says how to find out RTH. To find out RTH, first we have to make RL as open circuit. We have to name the endpoints as A and B. We have to de-energize the sources. Now, what is the meaning of de-energization? De-energization means if there is a voltage circuit or if there is a voltage, I will replace it with short circuit. If there is a current source, I will replace it with open circuit. So short circuit and open circuit. And finally, we will find out RAB, which is RTH. So this is the steps to find RTH. We will make RL as open circuit. We will name the endpoints as A and B. And we will de-energize the sources. And once we de-energize the sources, and after de-energizing the sources, we will find out RAB, which is same as RTH. So this is the step to find out RTH. To find out VTH, we will make RL as open circuit. We will name the endpoints as A and B, and we will find VAB. You remember I taught you how to find VAB. We'll find VAB, that is same as VTH. So these are the two important steps involved with Thevenin. So we will try to understand more of this with the help of an example. So no one has asked question on Thevenin as a doubt. So let me take my own problem of Thevenin. Okay, so let's take this example. This is a good example to solve.
Okay.
So this says, determine the Thevenin equivalent network and find the current through 30 ohm. This is the question. So let me just try to write it down on the board. Okay, so the question looks like this. This is 150. This is 15. This is 13. This is 16. This is 14. This is given as 30. And this is given as positive negative 50. So they want the current through this 30 ohm. That's what is the question. So the resistance through which we want current, that is known as RL, load resistance. So RL is 30. That is step number one. Now step number two is to find out RTH. To find out RTH, we will make RL as open circuit. We will name the endpoints as A and B. We will de-energize the sources. So 50 is a battery. We will make it as short circuit. Agreed? Now 40 will continue as it is. Now this 60 will also continue as it is. This 13 will become open circuit. This 15 will continue as it is. And this 150 will become short circuit. Okay, as I told you, voltages are replaced with short circuit and current is replaced with open circuit. So now, you see, we want to find RAB. So this open circuit has no special meaning, it will go away. 60 and 15 are in series and that's parallel with 45. So we can say RAB equals 40 parallel with 75. That will give you the answer. Okay, so this is how it goes. This is how we find out RTH. I repeat the steps once again. We make RL as open circuit. We name the endpoints as A and B. We de-energize the sources. And then after de-energizing the sources, we will find out RAB, which is same as RTH. So this is the Thevenin second step. First step was RL. Second step was RTH. RAB is same as RTH. Third step is to find out VTH. Okay. So to find out VTH, what we will do is, we will make RL as open circuit. So we will remove this RL. We will make this as open circuit. We will name the endpoints as A and B. And then we will find out VAB. So we have to find out VAB. That will give us the answer. Now you people know how to find out VAB. To find out VAB, we have to move from B to A. I told you, correct? In the earlier step. Whenever we want to calculate voltage VAB, we have to move from B to A. So I will be moving along this path. And along this path, which all elements are present, I will add their voltages. I will add their voltages as per KVL notation to get the answer. So 50 is fine, 50 is a battery, but across 40 I want current. So now how can we find out current? We can find out current easily by using mesh, correct? I can say this as I1, I2. There will be no current here because this is open circuit. So no current here. So we will have only two, I1 and I2. You will agree with me, I1 and I2 form super mesh. So the first equation will be I2 minus I1 equals 13. To get the second equation, just close this 13 and apply KVL on this. So it will be 150 minus 15 into I1 minus 60 into I2 minus 40 into I2. This is all equals to 0. So by solving these two equations, I will get the value of I2. Okay. So we can get the value of I2. I2, let's assume, is flowing like this. It has some value 5. I'm not solving this. Let's assume the value to be 5. In paper, you will have to solve. Here, just for the sake of simplicity, I'm assuming it to be 5 flowing downwards. Now, what we have to do? We have to move from B to A. So I say VAB equals, move from B to A. So positive to negative, this is negative, so it will be minus 50. I am moving up, current is coming down, so it will be plus 40 into 5. So this will give me voltage, VTH. Agreed? So we got RTH, we have RL, we have VTH. So final step is IL equals VTH upon RTH plus RL. Substitute these values and you will get the answer. So this is what is Thevenin theorem. Okay, so one question which is asked by Sakshi is of again Thevenin, so we will solve that. Okay, so this is asked by Sakshi, and the question goes like this. If G has an internal resistance of 30 ohm, find the current through it by using Thevenin. So that's the question, and the circuit looks like this. This is G. Okay, so this looks like this. This is 15, this is positive negative 10. So this is 10, this is 1, this is 5, this is 35, this is 10, this is 25, this is 15. And the question they are given, if G has an internal resistance of 30, find the current through it by using Thevenin. Okay. So whenever internal resistance of any component is given, we can replace that component with its internal resistance. This is the first rule. Okay, so this resistance is 0.5. Yes, that's correct. So the question goes like this. So the theorem goes like this. Whenever internal resistance of any component is given, we can replace that component with its internal resistance. Correct? So I can replace this with 30. Agreed? Now, before even we move further, so we all know RL is 30, the current through which we have to find out, that is 30. Now clearly you see a delta here, correct? So what first step we can do is convert from this delta to star. Someone asked me delta to star conversion. This small part will explain that also. So now this is delta. If I have to convert from delta to star, trick is very simple. So let's say I want R1. Now, R1 is between 35 and 10. So, R1 will be 35 into 10 upon all these three resistance additions. So, 35 plus 10 is 45 plus 5 is 50, correct? So, this becomes 50. Same way, R2 is 35 into 5 upon 50. So, the resistance which we want to find, between whom it is placed, we have to see. So 35 into 5 upon all these three resistances addition. And next becomes R3. R3 is again between 10 and 5, correct? So 10 into 5 upon 50. So this will give you some values. That values you will have to note down. So this same circuit will get converted like this. Will get converted like this. You see, the same circuit got converted like this. Okay, I think I missed one resistance. Here one resistance and here one more. This is the one which we get from there. This is 1. This is 0.5. This is 15. This is 25. This is 30. I don't have the values there, so you can calculate the values. For now, I put this as R1, R2 and R3. Okay. So now, first step is RL. Second step. So everyone understood this step. So first will be conversion like this, correct? Now once we converted like this, what we can do is, so some values I can find out. This is 350 by 50, correct? This should be 7. This is 3.5. This is 1. So these are the values which we got. So we can substitute there. So R1 will be 7. R2 will be 3.5. And R3 is 1, correct? So this is how the circuit goes. Now I can further simplify the circuit. So I will rub this question. So if I further simplify the circuit, this will be 30 and 7. I am not taking them in series intentionally. This 1 and 1.5 are in series, so it will become 1.5. This is 3.5 and 1 are in series, that becomes 4.5. And this is 25, this is 15, and this turns out to be, 100, correct? That turns out to be 10. So it's like this. So now this is the transformed question. So now we can take this as reference to calculate our RTH and RL. So hopefully this step is clear. So I'm going to rub this because we require space. So I'm rubbing this. Now we will take this as reference. So RL is 30. Second step is to find out RTH. So to find out RTH, I told you we will make RL as open circuit. We will name the endpoints as A and B. So 7 will continue as it is here. This 15 will continue as it is here. This 1.5 will continue as it is here. This 4.5 will continue here as it is, and this is 25, correct? It will be as it is, and this will be replaced with short circuit. I told you 10 is a voltage. Voltage gets replaced with short circuit. Now you see, this is a blank line, and this blank line is connecting 1.5 and 4.5. So what we can do is, imagine as if the blank line was not there. If the blank line was not there, you will agree with me, already the endpoints of 1.5 and 4.5 are same, one endpoint. And if I bring this 1.5 here like this, then the other endpoint will also form same. So what I mean to say is, the circuit will get transformed like this. 1.5 and 4.5. What I did was, I just kept this as reference and pulled this all the way till here. So this is 1.5, this is 25. Now you will agree with me, 15's endpoint is here, but second endpoint was with 1.5. Now 1.5 itself went here, so 15 will come like this. Hopefully this merging step everyone is clear. So when we do this, it comes like this. So 4.5 and 1.5 are in parallel. That will form a answer here. 25 and 15 are parallel. So finally, we will get some resistance like this. And some resistance like this. Correct? I don't have calci, else I will solve this. So 4.5 and 1.5 are in parallel. Whatever answer it comes. 25 and 15 are parallel. Whatever answer comes, it will come here. These two resistances are now in series. So this is how RTH is formed. Correct? So you can solve this further by using calci. You will get the value of RTH. The next step is to find out VTH. Okay, so I rub this. So to find out VTH, we will have to make RL as open circuit. We will name the endpoints as A and B. We want to find VAB. So you will agree with me. We can take this path, B to A. Now, how many meshes do you think you have? So since this is open circuit, this can be removed. So this entire thing is one mesh, I1. This entire thing is second mesh, I2. So we just have two meshes. Okay, so in mesh 1, what we can do is, we can apply current in mesh 1. So let's minus 25 into I1, minus 15 into I1, minus 1.5 into I1 minus I2, minus 4.5 into I1 minus I2. So you can simplify this, that will give you equation number 1. Second mesh starts from 10, minus 4.5 into I2 minus I1, minus 1.5 into I2 minus I1. Again, you can simplify this to get equation number 2. You have two equations, two unknowns. You can solve them and get the value of I1 and I2. Agreed? By solving this in calculator. Once you get I1 and I2, you see nothing will flow through 7 because 7 is part of open circuit. So we will have to just take 4.5 and the current flowing through this, and 25 and the current flowing through this. You know, current flowing through 25 is I1. So based upon I1 and I2, you can move along this path to get the answer. So once you get VTH, once you get RTH, we are done. Okay, so this is how we are. Any doubts on this question, anyone? So this solved two things. One question was asked by some student on star delta. We explained that also. And this also took care of Thevenin, correct? Now, one more question which is again asked by Sakshi only, I think, is of Nodal. So, we will take that. Okay, so I'll just give the hint so that you can solve it further. There is nothing special in this problem. This is 16 volt. So this is 16, this is 8, this is 4, this is 6, this is 30, this is 6. So you will agree this is the ground one. This is VA. This is very simple actually. This is I1, I2, I3, correct? So, we can say at node 1, I1 plus I2 plus I3, all this is equals to 0. I1 flows from VA. It goes all the way till ground. Intermediate, we have battery. So, minus 16, we are going from positive to negative upon 8. Plus I2, I2 is from VA. Is going to ground, but we have a battery. Battery is minus 30, correct? We are going from positive to negative upon 6. Plus third one is VA going to ground. 4 and 6 are in series. So VA by 10. All this will be equal to 0. Only one unknown. So you can solve VA and you will get the answer. Okay. Okay. So this is how what we have. Now, if you see maximum power theorem, there is one more theorem, maximum power theorem, and that theorem is also same as Thevenin only. So again we have to find VTH. You know how to find VTH. We again have to find RTH. I told you how to find RTH. Only difference is in maximum power theorem, last step is VTH square upon 4 RTH. VTH square upon 4 RTH. That's the only difference. Steps remain same. Same way in one theorem with name Norton, the step to find RTH is same, but there RTH is known as RN. And instead of finding VTH, we find out IN. We find out IN by making RL as short circuit. That's it. We will just make RL as short circuit and find the current through it, that is known as IN. So in Norton circuit, we find out RN and IN. That's the only difference. So this is how what we covered overall with respect to DC. Yes, I think we covered most of the problems which were asked by students. So I thank you very much for giving me an opportunity to present this. I try to cover as much as possible within the given timelines. We at Vidyalankar are very much focused on giving high quality education to students. And we solve a lot of more problems. So you can imagine within 1 hour itself, we solve so many problems which might not be covered in many colleges also. So you can imagine how well we must be conducting lectures in our regular batches. So if anyone is interested, you are welcome to attend our regular batches. We wish you all the best for your internals and the final exam. So wishing you all the best. Thank you.